Good morning. My name is Steve Fink. I'm the Assistant Athletic Director for Media Relations at the University of South Carolina. It's my pleasure to have you here this morning for this important press conference as we begin a new era of Gamecock football. For those of you looking to access the wireless internet, please use Athletics Guest. There is no password associated with that required, so please use Athletics Guest. Today we will hear from University President Dr. Harris Pastides, Athletics Director Ray Tanner, and the 34th head football coach at the University of South Carolina, Will Muschamp. After each has had an opportunity to share some remarks with you, we will open up questions for Coach Muschamp. If you have a question at that time, please raise your hand. We'll get a microphone to you. And we would ask that you also introduce yourself so Coach gets to know your name and face along with your affiliation. After the question and answer session, there'll be an opportunity for photos with all three of our speakers. So with that, I'm happy to turn the program over to the President of the University of South Carolina, Dr. Harris Pastides.
Well, thank you, Stephen. Good morning, and you set the tone right. Welcome to a new era of University of South Carolina Gamecock football. Welcome to everybody. I see so many of you who are so important to us, our trustees, Mark Bike Jr., Chairman Gene War, Chairman Emeritus Herbert Adams, Trustee Tommy Cofield, Thad Westbrook, Doran Smith, Hugh Mobley, Secretary Amy Stone, members of our Gamecock Club, the fan base, students, faculty, and members of the media. I could not be more excited to be looking forward and looking ahead to matching our great football program with the other success we're having at the university. After this weekend with a men's and women's basketball victory, I believe Coach Tanner, we remain the only Division I university with an undefeated men's and women's basketball team. Our facilities in athletics have very few peers. Our academics have improved vastly. We're a globally recognized university. We have great partners like Boeing and IBM. But let me save the best to last. The Gamecock fans have no rival. And I think Coach Will Muschamp is about to experience that himself very quickly. Coach Tanner will say a few words, of course, in introducing Will and his family who are here. I had an opportunity to meet them last evening. And what a family they are. They were all meant to be Gamecocks. His wife, Carol, his older son, Jackson, and his younger son, Witt. Both Jackson and Witt were decked out in Gamecock attire when they came to the house last night. And I don't know about all the criteria. I'll let Ray talk to you about that. But I happen to like that the name Muschamp is spelled with USC champ right there. So let's welcome our athletic director, Ray Tanner.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today for this exciting announcement. Please join me in remembering December 7th, 1941, and every day the men and women of our armed forces that protect our country. I'd like to take a few moments to thank people who helped me get to this point. Those of you who know me well know that I need a lot of help, so I'm very grateful for our group of advisors that assisted me. Ken Wheat, one of our former football players, 1969 ACC championship team. I.S. Levy Johnson, who's an attorney and a community leader here in Columbia. Chip Comer, who's the chairman of the Gamecock Club Board of Directors. Ms. Joan Gable, Executive Vice President of Academic Affairs and Provost. Susie Van Huss, who is a former faculty academic advisor. And the chairman of the board, Mr. Gene Moore. And lastly, our own number 21, Marcus Lattimore. I'd like to thank our Board of Trustees throughout this process, and of course, Dr. Pastides. Eastman and Bodine, who have been a tremendous help. I'd like to also thank the media members that are here today and cover our student athletes at a level that I'm not sure any school in the country has the opportunity. Throughout this process, your professionalism has been exemplary, and I appreciate that. I'd like to thank Lance Grantham from our staff, who asked lots of questions and provided a lot of research. Charles Bloom, who has been with us every step of the way and has done a lot of research as well. Lastly, our Deputy Athletics Director, Charles Waddell, who sat with me through long conversations from day to day. And I'm proud to tell you that there were a couple of occasions where we skipped a meal, and that's not like us. I've been preparing for this coaching transition for quite some time, and I was reminded from time to time that the search timetable didn't necessarily fit everybody on the internet or our fan base. From the very beginning, I felt that we would be in a position by late last week or the first of this week to name a football coach at the University of South Carolina. And that has happened. And while maybe there has been a little time to get to this point, the thing that was so important that the time that we spent would result in a football coach for a long, long time. During our meeting with the group of advisors, we had great conversations, and obviously the word integrity stays at the top of the list on any talk that goes in any direction. But I want to share some things that became very important to Charles and I as we went through this process. You know, while everybody loves a great offense and running 90 to 100 plays at a time and scoring 48 points, and we would like that too, we also like defense where somebody can stop it when the other team may be on their run. A lot of people can score points today, and a lot of people can't stop teams from scoring. And I don't think that you would question what Coach Muschamp brings on the defensive side of the ball. And I'll tell you, last night in our team meeting, he got the offense pretty excited about the opportunities we will have on that side going forward. Just a couple of notes. While he was at the University of Florida as a coach, his defense was in the top 10 three of the 4 years that he was there. You turn the conversation to recruiting. Three times out of the 4 years at University of Florida, his recruiting class was in the top five. We want coaches around us with a tireless work ethic. That goes without saying. Yesterday morning, I took a very relaxing flight over to pick Coach Muschamp and his family up. It's quite pleasant, quite beautiful. And as he boarded the plane, he began to work. And he took me past 10 o'clock last night. I know that as I watched him juggle four or five things at a time, I'm not capable of being on his staff. I asked Carol, is he like this all the time? She said yes, but he'll still lose his car keys and his identification. So that was good to hear. Passion is second to none. We wanted somebody who could coach and teach. No question about that with Coach Muschamp. Media savvy, natural leader. Relationship with players. Last night, I was inundated with texts that I got from players that he's coached in the past. Knowledge of the Southeast in our footprint, unparalleled. You can't have a better coach in the country in that capacity. The academic priority, the excellence as a head coach at the University of Florida was apparent. We have a coach that fits so many great characteristics. A few days ago, Charles and I had the opportunity to visit with Coach Muschamp. We started out with a little dinner early evening, and quickly that conversation lasted to the wee hours of the next morning. After sleeping for just a few hours, I decided that everybody should be awake if I'm awake, and I called Coach Muschamp, and I said, "Are you awake?" He said yes. I'm not sure he was. But I said, how about coming back and visiting with me for a little while longer? And while he's probably thinking, that man is crazy. We visited for two more hours. And there's no doubt in my mind, with his knowledge, his expertise, and experience. He's the man most suited to lead our football program at the University of South Carolina. He will give us an opportunity to be at the top of the conference and get us in the national conversation. I'm delighted to be able to welcome Carroll and Jackson and Witt. And by the way, both of those young men throw tight spirals. I saw that yesterday. And as the president said, you spell Muschamp with an M, hyphen, 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 USC, champ. Is that an omen or what? Please join me in welcoming our 34th head football coach at the University of South Carolina, Coach Will Muschamp.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Please sit down. I promised everybody a dollar if you'd stand up when I walked up here. I didn't bring that many dollars. So really excited to be here. Really excited to be a South Carolina Gamecock. Carol and I and the boys are thrilled to be your head football coach and lead this program. As Coach Spurrier has raised the level here, raised the expectation level here, and we're excited about meeting that challenge and that opportunity, and we embrace everything as far as the expectations of winning championships here in Columbia, and that's going to happen. I want to thank President Pastides and investing the confidence in me to get the job done. There's no question that any organization's got to have leadership at the top, and since 2008, he's done a phenomenal job here at South Carolina. And to be able to sit in his beautiful home last night with his wife, Patricia, and talk to them and see how down-to-earth they are and their genuine thoughts about the University of South Carolina and where this program is headed. I'm looking forward to that partnership moving forward. I want to thank Coach Tanner, obviously. It was a long process. I'll be honest, that was a long day. I can tell you that. Charles Waddell, I'm looking forward to working with you. Great to have dinner last night with Coach Tanner and Karen, his wife, and his three children. Luke and Maggie and Gracie, that if you ever wanted to get some energy, go hang out with them a little while. They fly around the table now. They're a lot of fun. But we had a great time last night, and as we've started this process in talking to him and his vision for the head coach at South Carolina, his vision for this program and where he sees it headed, it got me more and more excited. But more than anything in the process, him talking about him coming to South Carolina and his vision for the baseball program, because I really see myself a little bit somewhat like Coach Tanner, a blue-collar guy going to outwork you, and a guy that's got a tremendous vision for where we're going to head with this thing, and we're going to have a lot of fun doing it. But, Coach, I appreciate it. Appreciate your support and investing the confidence in me to be here. I'm certainly excited about that. I can't go any further without thanking my wonderful wife, Carol. She is a great mom, and I love you. Stand up, please. And Gamecock Nation, if you don't think I can recruit, look at her and look at me. I can sell ice to an Eskimo. So that's a strong point you better have as a ball coach, and she's been wonderful. My two boys, Jackson and Witt, I don't know where Jackson is right now. He's probably out working out somewhere. But Witt, two great kids that have, as a coach's family and as a coach's wife, you sacrifice a lot for the coach's career. And they've done that. And I can't thank you guys enough for what you've done. There's a great blend here. Anytime I meet with a student athlete, I talk in terms of a great blend academically, athletically, socially, and spiritually, for what you're looking for in a school. And I see that here at South Carolina. I look at academically what we've done with our student athletes, the Doty Center, and that's the best there is in the country. And the academic support we're gonna have for the student athletes and provide for them, not just about academically, but about life. And that's really important in the maturation process for these young men to continue to further their lives and launch their careers when football's over. Because it's all gonna end. Less than 4% of the young men that play college football make it more than 4 years in the National Football League, and that's where retirement cuts off. So let's be realistic about how long they're going to play after their careers are over here at the University of South Carolina. And the support from that center and from the people within that center is outstanding. The spiritual support to give the young men outlets for what they want to be able to accomplish, and to make sure there's things and there's people that they can talk to that maybe they won't talk to Coach Muschamp about, but they certainly have those people to reach out to. And then socially, the diverse campus that we have, that certainly Coach President Pastides has really pushed for. It's really, really exciting that a young man can come on this campus, but also in the city of Columbia, and have a wonderful experience and a great college experience. And that's really important to me. It goes a lot further than Saturday afternoon with me. You know, we're with them Sunday through Friday, and the growing process of a young man and the future leaders of our country. And that's really important to me. And then athletically, football is a developmental sport. So you've got to develop, and you start it with the evaluation process in high school. And it's really important to evaluate the film. I was doing that late last night and into this morning for our next signing class. And then looking at those young men, seeing if they're the right fit, see if they have the right character, if they're going to represent the University of South Carolina in a first-class manner. Again, very important to me that they're going to do that. But then develop them on the field as well. And I'll put our track record up against anybody as far as the development of players when you get them on campus, because that's critical as well. And then winning a championship. And again, as I said earlier, Coach Spurrier raised the expectation level here, and we're gonna continue to push that forward and push the envelope to winning championships consistently here in Columbia. And I look forward to doing that. I met with the team last night and really asked them three things that that they would bring every day to work. And that number one is just great energy in what you do, whether it's academically, whether it's athletically, whatever you do in life, let's do it hard. Let's do it with great energy and great passion with what you're trying to do. Talked about great effort. Whatever you do, let's give great effort. You know, if you do that, good things are going to happen for you eventually. And then obviously you got to have a positive attitude in everything you got. You look at the facilities here, and I know, you know, talking in terms of the new operations facility, I'm really excited about that. But everything is on par for us to be very, very successful. So let's take advantage of the wonderful opportunities we have here. I talked to the team about change is inevitable in life, and growth is optional. You know, change happens. There's a lot of times you can't do anything about it. And what's happened as far as, you know, Coach Spurrier moving on and whether or not the staff's going to be here or not, those are things that are out of your control. But the growth, you can control. So grow with us in what we're trying to do. We're going to assemble an outstanding staff. I'm going to address that as we move forward. But guys are going to do a great job and represent this university in a first-class manner. And I think the players really warmed up to that. We want to be a blue-collar, overachieving outfit. That's what we want to be known for. If we recruit good enough players that buy into that work ethic, a lot of special things are going to happen for us. And I certainly think that the talent base within South Carolina, we need to win the state back recruiting. That's the most important thing. You talk in terms of going into North Carolina, Georgia, and Florida, and obviously recruiting some of the Northeast guys with direct flights from Washington and Philadelphia and New Jersey, flying directly into Columbia. You can access your kids to some kids in the Northeast, but we need to win the state back first. I understand that, and that's what we need to do, and that's where my efforts this week certainly are going to be focused. But I'm going to answer some obvious questions. First question probably would be about the offense. I think last year at Auburn was outstanding for me to work with Gus Malzahn, who, first of all, is a first-class individual, a great person, and an outstanding football coach. Really, probably over the last 10 years offensively, he's done as good a job as anybody in the country. And the last year at Auburn was fantastic for me. Sit back and see how he administered some things. And that's really identity-wise what we want to be. We want to be on the ball. We want to be fast. We want to be physical. We want to be able to be on the ball, spread the field, make them defend the 53 and a third yards wide and 120 yards deep on the field. And that's really what we want to be offensively, and I think our guys are really excited about that. Defensively, my hands will be on a lot of it, and I think everywhere we've been, the track record speaks for itself as far as the success we've had. But that also goes back to good players. Is what I'm going to do this week is get on the road recruiting, and that's what we need to do. But I think we'll commingle based on front-wise and coverage-wise, based on what we have. I'm not going to ask a player to do something he can't do. If a guy can't cover a bucket of water, I ain't going to ask him to play man-to-man. So those are things, to me, as a coach, you evaluate, and you evaluate what your guys can do, and you fit your system to what your guys can do. And I think that's really important. We're going to be really aggressive on special teams. To be able to control the vertical field position in the game is really, really critical, and that's something that we understand that's one-third of the game. Obvious question about staffing. I kind of hit on that already. I want to hold off on getting ahead of myself as far as those things are concerned. Don't believe everything you read or what you write. So I think that I know everybody's got the staff figured out, and just let me know when you know. So, but we have an outstanding staff here, and I met with some of those guys last night, and moving forward, I'm going to hire the best guys for us. I'm going to hire the right fit for us, the best coaches for us, and the best fit for South Carolina. And that may take some time, and I'm not going to put a timetable on it, because at the end of the day, you want the best fit for our young men. You know, it's our job as coaches to really service the players. If it weren't for the players, we wouldn't have jobs. Now, within that, we've got to hold them accountable to make them dependable and continue to grow and mature as young men, as athletes, as students, and all of those things. But we're going to hire the best staff available. Probably we'll get some questions about sideline demeanor. Coach Tanner and I have talked extensively about his expectations of the head coach of the University of South Carolina. And I'm certainly in accordance with everything that he wants done. I am a passionate guy. I do have a competitive edge about me. I do coach with a lot of energy on the field. And I want our players to play with relentless effort and great energy and great passion, because I have been coaching a long time, and I do know that your players generally take the personality of the coach. And I want our guys playing with that type of competitive edge every time they go out, but also representing South Carolina in a first-class manner. And that's what we're going to do. I know one thing. I'm going to be really excited of running out of that tunnel Williams-Bryce in 2001 cranks up. I can tell you that right now. It gets goosebumps thinking about it. But really excited about that. I'll probably get asked about, you know, what happened at Florida and what have you learned. I think it's great to reflect, have some perspective on what you did well, because we did a lot of things very well. It didn't end the way I wanted to. My first day on the job, I sat with our president, Dr. Bernie Matchin, and came in my office one-on-one and shut the doors and he said, clean it up. You need to clean the place up. And we did that. We left a program much better than we inherited. It didn't end the way we wanted to, but we graduated our players. We had the highest grade point average in school history for consecutive semesters, my last four semesters there, and we did things the right way. So I'm certainly, anytime you're able to reflect and take some perspective on what happened, you got to be willing to learn. You know, that's one of the things you got to be able to do is look back. And there's nobody that's going to be more self-critical of themselves than myself as far as what we need to do to be successful and as we evaluate ourselves moving forward here. And with that, I'll open it up for any questions you might have.
Again, we'll get a microphone to you right here in front, David.
David Kloniger, The State. Will, when did you first get contacted by Ray, and when did this process first start?
I believe it was last Thursday. I believe sent me a text and asked if he wanted to talk, and we had a good conversation that morning. I immediately let Coach Malzahn know that South Carolina had contacted me, and I believe we met. It was Wednesday or Thursday, and we met a couple days after that. And as Coach Tanner kind of alluded to, we had a very deliberate, very good meeting. It was a long meeting. It was a good meeting, and get to know you and plan for the program on both sides, because I think that's important to see what his vision is as well. And I thought we agreed on a lot of things we need to do.
Brian.
You kind of alluded to it, Brian Hand, Spurs and Feathers. You kind of alluded to it, but when you started thinking about you officially taking the job, what sold you on South Carolina?
Well, I think that number one, the success Coach Spurrier's had, and he's come in here and certainly has raised the level. I knew about the facility improvements that were headed. I knew about the indoor. I knew about some of the things. But, I, as much as anything, you meet with Coach Tanner and you see here's a guy that wants the best for the University of South Carolina. Here's a guy that loves the University of South Carolina, has invested his life in the University of South Carolina. And when you see an investment like that, that kind of motivates you as a coach, and you understand if this guy's willing to do the things it takes to be successful, then I certainly want to be a part of that team. And it certainly is. To me, it's a team, and I think anywhere I've ever worked, you want to talk to any president or any athletic director or any administrator, it is a team, and you do it all together. And that's certainly, when I talk in terms of partnership, that's what I'm talking about. Y'all are easy.
Stand there in the front.
Colin Taylor, Gamecock Central. You mentioned Steve Spurrier's success here. What's your mentality in trying to inherit a program from one of college football's probably greatest coaches?
Well, again, I think that, as I told the players, you know, change is inevitable in life and growth's optional. We're going to do things a certain way. And, again, it's hard to – there's only one Coach Spurrier, let's be honest. So I'm going to be Will Muschamp, and that's what I need to be in this situation, and that's what we'll do moving forward. I'm certainly going to reach out to him because there's nobody that – it's easy for everybody, and I got about 80,000 on Saturday that will give me great advice. But he sat behind the chair, and he understands what it's like to be there, and I'll certainly cherish those opportunities to talk to him.
David.
David Caravello, Charleston Post and Charleston Post Courier. Will, I mean, how different are you as a head coach now compared to your time at Florida, and how much different do you think you're going to operate here as opposed to there?
Well, I've gained about 15 pounds. I didn't exercise very good this fall. I think as much as anything, you know, it's kind of like marriage, you know. That first year, there's a little adjustment. And that fifth year, you're doing a little better. It's no different than being a father. That first couple things that pop up, you kind of look at and you think, you got to be kidding me. I got to do this, you know. And then you start moving forward, you kind of understand it a little bit more. No different than being a defensive coordinator. Your first year, you kind of, wow, there's a lot to this. And then the game slows down for you as you go. It's no different than being a position coach. So I would liken it to possibly being a CEO of an organization, which I've never been. But the more experience you have at it, the more things you see. As I always talk in terms of freshmen playing, the game starts to slow down a little bit. And you are able to anticipate a little bit more things that may happen, whether it's staff-wise, whether it's roster-wise, whether it's attitude-wise, whether it's practice-wise. And you're able to see a lot of those things and have a little bit more anticipation. One of the, a guy that I worked for that I think is as good as anybody in the country with anticipation of issues is Nick Saban. And I think that's one of his strengths. He anticipates things happen. Mack Brown was outstanding at anticipating things happen. You know, they saw things happening. And as an assistant coach, never sitting behind the chair, the desk there, how did he know that was going to happen? Well, it's experience. And there's certainly leaning on that past experience is going to help me a lot.
John.
John Whittle, TheBigSquare.com. I was wondering if you had a timetable to announce any of your staff members, be it a couple of staff or the entire staff.
No, I won't wait for the entire staff, obviously, because different guys have different obligations at other schools. But when I know it's official that we're able to name a guy, you'll know as quick as I know. I'll make sure you know. I don't have any timetable, though, no.
Gene.
Hey, Will. Gene Sapica from the Charleston Post and Courier. Would you agree that it's easier to recruit at Florida than at South Carolina? If you agree with that, how are you going to compensate for that? If you don't agree with that, why don't you agree with that?
You see where I got my undergraduate degree? I may struggle with that question. I think a lot of recruiting goes into relationships, number one. Number two, it goes into region, population, and obviously at the University of Florida, the population of some of the cities and the surrounding areas you have within them. I always look at it as a five-hour radius. You know, that's a day trip for a family to see Johnny play on Saturday afternoon and be able to get back home. So within a five-hour radius, do we have the number of players that a place like Florida has within that five-hour radius? I'm not going to sit there and say that. But I also look at recruiting rankings. I've never worried about how many stars they had by their name. I really haven't. I've never looked at Rivals or any of that stuff, no offense to any of you guys, and looked and said, well, he's a five-star. We must like him, you know, because I've signed a bunch of two-stars that were really good football players and are still playing in the National Football League. But it goes back to what I said in my original statement. It's about the evaluation, and does this young man fit for what we want? And then the development on campus, whether it's in football IQ, it's in the weight room, as far as coaching is concerned, and all the experiences we've had before. So, again, I'm going to find guys who are going to fit for our program. Are there players within a five-hour radius to have a high-ranking recruiting class? I assume so. I really don't know because I don't get involved with that. We offer young men that are going to come here that fit what we want to do within our systems offensively, defensively, and special teams. So as far as the rankings concerned, I don't really get a whole lot of concerned with that. I know our fans do, and I know our fan base will get really excited about a five-star. But at the end of the day, it's not really about winning in February. It's about winning in the fall. And winning with good football players are going to represent this university in a first-class manner.
Let's go to the back, Corey.
Coach Muschamp, Corey Miller, Watch Fox Sports. Have you seen much of this roster, this team that you're going to inherit? And then number two, have you contacted any of the guys that committed to South Carolina and old staff?
I'm meeting with the team last night, a lot of familiar faces, a couple guys. I'm glad they turned me down, so that was good to see those guys. But, again, I, you know, I don't want to make any comments until you're able to work with a young man and see his work ethic and his competitive edge and all of those things, and obviously the physical attributes you want to see. And I have reached out to some players that we're recruiting here, and I can't comment really any further than that.
Coach Chris Traynor with the Free Times here in Columbia,
mm-hmm.
Back here. You mentioned that things didn't end exactly the way you wanted them to at Florida. What does it mean to you personally then to get a second chance at a head coaching job in the SEC, considering it didn't end the way you wanted it to?
Well, I think, again, that's Coach Tanner's and President Pastidi's confidence in me to get the job done here at South Carolina. So in the interview process, obviously they felt like that I could get that job done, so I'm appreciative of the opportunity.
Let's go over here to the right.
Coach Muschamp, Andy Shane from the State Paper. You had mentioned demeanor earlier. Is there an expectation difference in demeanor between being a coordinator and being a head coach, and how might your demeanor be different than what we saw this year at Auburn?
Well, I think absolutely there's a huge difference in being the head coach and defensive coordinator. There's no question. And I think as a head coach, obviously, you're thinking through other situations offensively, special teams, making those decisions, as well as defensively. As a defensive coordinator, I'm focused and concentrated on one side of the ball and one side of the ball only. And so certainly demeanor certainly could change, yeah.
Stay to the right.
Obviously, Scott Eisberg, WCIV in Charleston, not obviously on that, but obviously this year, Clemson, number one in the country, heading to the playoff in the state, much of the talk, everything kind of skewing towards Clemson now. Any plans to kind of, pull South Carolina back even in the race, if you will, as far as perspective within the state of South Carolina and with recruits?
We're just going to worry about the University of South Carolina.
Right there. Go ahead.
James Carpia from AL.com. Will, there was some improvement down the stretch at Auburn, but year over year there was statistical regression. How do you explain it, and do you have any regrets about this past year at Auburn?
Well, absolutely. I mean, our regrets over a 6-6 season. I'm not a big stat guy. I've explained that to you multiple times. But, again, I think we made tremendous improvements as the year went, and certainly added some very good players to the program. I hate the fact that those kids have got to go through a change again as defensive coordinator. That's something that I certainly regret, that they've got to face that. It's very difficult. But that's a great situation there. Gus does a fantastic job. And I'm really, hurt that we couldn't continue to move forward, but certainly excited about the opportunity here.
Josh.
Josh Kendall with the State. Will, do you have any philosophical differences in how you will handle the offense or how you think the offense ought to be handled from your time at Florida?
Well, again, I think, in describing, a little bit about what we did at Auburn is much different than in my first 3 years, not my last year at Florida. We still needed to be more productive, and that falls on my shoulders. But philosophically, we want to snap the ball as many times as possible and score as many points as we can, and that's what we plan on doing.
Go to Reggie over here.
Reggie Anderson.
The more times you snap it, the better chance you got to score. I have figured that out.
Reggie Anderson, WLTX-TV here in Columbia. You mentioned Coach Saban and Coach Brown. What about some of the other coaches, maybe your high school coach, coaches at Georgia that influenced you?
Well, it'd be unfair to mention any of them because they've all had a huge impact on my career. My high school coach, Jerry Sharp, was outstanding. I worked for Roy Kidd at Eastern Kentucky, won over 300 games, and is as good a coach as I've ever come across. Is common sense, smart, tough, hard-nosed. Just loved being around the man in the time that I was there, and one of the great coaches all time. Now, he was at Eastern Kentucky, so he didn't have the fanfare that a lot of these other guys do, but certainly an outstanding coach. But again, I've been very blessed and fortunate to have been around some of the great coaches all time in college football.
Let's go way back to the left.
Coach John Wagner, Capital City Sports with Student Media. What's your message to the students coming off a 3-win season and, that the students may not know much about you?
Well, again, I want them to support the student-athletes, support their peers, and that's the most important thing they need to be able to do right now. Let's get exciting going. I'm going to be out in the community. I'm going to be on campus. I think it's very important for them to be recognizable to me and being the head coach of the University of South Carolina. But let's get behind these young men and let's support them.
Right there in the middle.
Coach John Del Bianco with the Big Spur. Can you just talk about what kind of goals you could set for yourself in this first season, long term, and then what kind of ceiling you see for this program?
Well, again, the ceiling's limitless. We're about winning championships here. Okay, I've stated that and I believe that. So But I'm not going to get into goals right now. Right now, I'm focused on recruiting. I'm focused on our players finishing exams very well. I said that multiple times last night, to finish strong academically. I'm big into accountability for them. And if they come in there and don't do well on exams, I can't count on them. You know, if they're not going to do well on exams, that's very important to me, because generally the guys that are pain in the butt off the field are pain in the butt on the field. Does that make sense? So I want to be able to have guys that enjoy being here and going to do things the right way. That's really important. But I'm not going to get into setting a bunch of goals right now. But I do know what the expectation is, and that's winning a championship.
Phil.
Phil Kornblut, South Carolina Radio Network. After meeting with Ray, when did you get the offer? What did you think when you got the offer, and how long did it take you? What was the process after that in making your decision?
Well, I guess we talked Saturday morning, I believe, and I don't know the exact timetable of everything, but it didn't take long. This is where I wanted to be, and I made that very evident in the interview process as we continued to move into the wee hours of the night, and I could see Charles was getting a little tired, and I figured he was wanting to go to bed. But I made it very clear that this is where I wanted to be, and this is where I wanted to be for a long time. My son Jackson's going in ninth grade. We've moved and been very unfair to him, and this is where we're going to be. This is where we want to be, and I'm excited about that. But I made it very evident in the conversation that we had that this is where we wanted to be.
Let's go over here first to the left, then we'll come back to Jackson.
Coach Brad Fralick with WIFF in Greenville. How quickly can you spin around talent on a football team, just simply because of the drop-off that's happened over the last couple of years here from the 11-win seasons? How quickly is that a one-season, two-season, three-season thing?
You know, to me, it's day-to-day. It's go recruiting, improve your program, get the guys on campus to buy into what you're trying to do, offensively, defensively, and special teams, and that's what we're going to do.
Let's go back to the right to Rick.
Rick Henry, WIS-TV here in Columbia. Coach, as a new coach coming into a program, is it important to you to reach out to former players to get their support and help with what you're trying to do?
Absolutely. You know, the experiences that these guys had in playing in Williams-Brice and playing at the University of South Carolina is really, really important to me, to be able to have and build that bridge with those guys with our football team. I think that's critical, and I'm going to constantly have guys talking to our team about their experiences at the University of South Carolina. I think that is really, really important to me. And certainly being able to possibly have former South Carolina players on our staff in some form or fashion, I think is really important.
Go to Matt.
Will, Matt Connolly with the State Newspaper. I know you said you didn't want to comment much on the staff, but just how important is it to have a staff that will come out and recruit and work hard in the recruiting area?
It's always been my philosophy. You better have your play caller. You better have you a good defensive coordinator. You better have you an offensive line coach. And if the rest of them can't recruit, they can't coach here. That's the bottom line.
Let's go to the back on the right.
Pete Gannady from WSPA-TV in Spartanburg. You've been in a lot of different programs as a coordinator and then, of course, at Florida as a head coach. Obviously, the responsibilities are different, but what's the biggest adjustment being the head coach as opposed to being the coordinator that you had to deal with when you got to Florida, and then maybe thinking about it in the past year that you encounter trying to separate that head coaching role from being the coordinator and some of the responsibilities that are ahead of you here?
A lot more meetings with guys like you. I don't mean that in a derogatory manner at all. But no, you just have a lot more responsibility outside of coaching football. You know, you have a lot more media responsibility. I'm not complaining about it. I'm just saying that's the bottom line. You have a lot more things coming across your desk. Bill Parcells called me when I went to Florida and said, you know, you ever seen those things in the apartment buildings in New York City? I said, I don't know exactly what you're talking about. I'm from the South, but go ahead. And he said, you know, those conveyor things that they come out and they're cleaning out an apartment building and they throw the trash and it sucks it up and dumps it into a dumpster at the bottom. He said, that's your desk now as a head coach. And he's probably right after a while. So there's just a lot more things as far as, you know, you obviously have your coaching responsibilities, your recruiting responsibilities, but then your media responsibilities. You're going, obviously you need to get out in the community. You need to get on campus. You need to get to the Gamecock clubs. I mean, those are things that are really, really important. And it's critical that you represent that in a first-class manner for South Carolina. And there's just a lot more responsibility outside of just ball coaching. Being the head coach. And that's, to me, in a nutshell, that's probably the biggest difference. No disrespect at all.
Bill Gunner, Fox Sports Radio here in Columbia.
from your time at LSU and then at Florida, can you just talk about your perception from the outside on the South Carolina program as you've watched them over your time?
Well, that very difficult place to play. Passionate, great fan base that's going to support the Gamecocks. You know, that's the number one thing that jump out at you. And then obviously the run Coach Spurrier had here was outstanding. So again, very excited to represent the fan base.
Stay the right halfway back, Heath.
Coach, you alluded Heath Klein, 107.5 The Game. You alluded to the areas you want to hit in recruiting. Can you talk for fans about how you might want to structure anything beyond the coaches, any kind of personnel department, analysts, any kind of thing like that?
Excuse me. Well, I think the support staff is a huge part that we're moving forward, and Coach Tanner fully supports that as far as the things we need to do off the field with the recruiting office and the manpower you've got to have to be successful. Again, when you have so many duties as a coach, as a head coach, you have to have people behind the scenes that do a fantastic job for you as far as setting things up, as far as recruiting is concerned. And that's certainly something we're moving forward and pushing the envelope with.
Your second row.
Danny Garrison from thebigspur.com. In terms of a personality fit from what you've seen so far, where does this program rank in terms of other places you've landed at?
The top.
Pete Iacobelli, Associated Press. Will, how hands-on do you get with your defense, and do you have to kind of contain yourself at times from wanting to do even more out there with them?
Well, I think, you know, you need to play to your strengths as a coach, as a head coach, and that's certainly, a strength of mine. And so I'm very involved defensively, but also on special teams. I'm the recruiting coordinator, too. And then, you know, I like to be able to be around the offense enough to where the offensive kids know that we're there. And as far as the decision making on game day, obviously, but certainly I think you play to your strengths, and that's my strengths.
We got one more here, John, in the middle.
How would you describe your relationship with Coach Spurrier, and did you talk to him after you got the offer and just about the program? What to expect here, some of the challenges?
Well, you know, Coach Spurrier is a guy that I really look up to. He's a Hall of Fame football coach and Hall of Fame player, and a guy that I've got tremendous respect for. We have a very good relationship. I have not talked to him since I've taken the job or prior to that. But listening to him, we spend a lot of time on planes to Bristol every summer, talking about programs and talking about how fond he was of Columbia, how he and Jerry really loved living here, the program, Coach Tanner, the president. I mean, all of the things, he was ultra positive about his experience. And so just kind of going back through and thinking through some of the things that he said that were really important to me and the relationships that he and Jerry had here and how good it was for them and how much they've enjoyed their time here really was important. But we haven't had it as much. He left me a message, and I need to give him a call as soon as possible.
Stay here in the third row.
Will, you had said that you hate for the Auburn players that they're going to have to go through another change again on defensive coordinator. Your departure is going to be the fourth DC in 5 years, seventh in 10 years. Can you just speak to the challenge that your successor there will be facing, if it's possible to have success under that much turnover? And besides Travaris Robinson and Bobby Bentley, if anyone else from Auburn will be joining your staff?
Well, again, I'm not really ready to comment on staffing at this point. I'll certainly let you know when I know. But, again, I think that there's some good, really good football players on that defense and some guys that, played extremely well for them this year. And I certainly believe there's a lot of success to be had. There's no question about that. Is it difficult to go through another transition for those players? It certainly is. And I hate it for those kids. I hate it for their experience to have to hit that.
Stay on the right.
Tim Daly, 107.5 The Game, flagship station for the Gamecock Sports. Looking back on other QB decisions, like at Florida, are you a more pocket passing QB? Do you prefer that or a running QB? Are you a one QB guy, two QB guy? Just curious.
I really like the guy that wins. So, again, Connor Shaw was as good a competitor at the quarterback position that maybe I've, coached again. I mean, there's been a lot of great competitors. I mean, I'm not trying to say, but here's a guy that, I don't know how fast he was, and I really don't know how well he threw the ball, but I know one thing, he won a lot of games. So I don't really want to, put yourself in a corner of what kind of quarterback you like. You like a winner. You like a guy with intangibles that positively affects everybody in the organization, because if you don't get it right at that position, it affects the entire organization. Who goes to the playoffs every year? Wherever Peyton Manning's playing and wherever Tom Brady's playing. And that's why that position is so critical, because it not only affects offensively your production, but it affects your entire organization defensively, special teams, the decisions you make as a coach. How aggressive can you be? Does he take care of the ball? There's a lot of things that are involved with that. Take away the ability. Certainly a quarterback with legs gives you more problems defensively, because you could be in a good call, a good situation, and a guy with legs can make you wrong, like Carnell Shaw did on a touchdown here in 2011 on third down, right in this end zone. I remember it. We lost contain, and we had nobody left, and we couldn't catch him. But those are things to me that, you know, you look at the intangible things as much as anything of guys that can win and guys that positively affect the guys around them. That is critical in that role, and that's certainly something that Connor did here at South Carolina.
Let's go to Ben and Pete.
Hi, Ben Briner from the State. At Florida, how much did you involve yourself hands-on in the offense, and do you change that involvement anymore this go-round?
As far as I didn't, you know, call any plays, in any of that. I mean, philosophically, you go into a game with a plan of how you're going to win the game. And if that means we got to take as many shots as we need to take, that's a game planning issue. And then the offensive coordinator calls the plays. So that's what we plan on doing here, and certainly need better results than we had at Florida.
Stand right there.
Coach Evan West from WCBD in Charleston, back here. What's your sales pitch to recruits who may be watching this press conference, and what are you selling them on Columbia?
Well, again, I think that what I kind of stated earlier, the great blend that we have here academically, athletically, socially, and spiritually for a young man to come in here and have great success at the state university, at the University of South Carolina, okay? So that's a great – to play in the Southeastern Conference, there's no better conference. You're going to go play in places like Athens. You're going to go to the Swamp. You're going to go play in Williams-Brice every Saturday afternoon. That's hard to beat, and that's an exciting part of being a South Carolina Gamecock, and certainly – moving forward from a facility standpoint, it's going to be hard for a young man to turn us down, the way I look at it.
Pete.
Coach, I know you said you wanted to be here, but was this the only school to reach out to you during this recent couple of weeks period? And did you think a year ago when you left Florida that you'd have this opportunity this soon? Were you a little bit surprised that another head coaching job of this level came up this soon?
I had some other schools reach out as a possible head coaching situation that I didn't pursue, quite frankly, and so I just didn't feel like they were a good fit for me and my family. This certainly was the perfect fit for us and what we wanted to do, and that's why we pursued it. I've been involved in this game for a long time, and you never know the opportunities are going to present themselves. So you do a good job with the job you have. You work extremely hard. You do things the right way. You represent the university in a first-class manner. Good things are going to happen for you, and good things happen to good people. So I guess we've done some good things over the way.
We'll take two more, one here in front.
Coach, South Carolina players, when they graduate, they usually stay close to the university. Have you gotten a chance to talk to a couple of them since you've been in town, and what kind of feedback?
I really haven't, but I'm looking forward to that, and certainly having these guys involved in the program, absolutely.
And Shane?
Coach, you've mentioned a couple times how spiritually this is a place. How important is that in your program that kids, that the students understand that, and how does that reflect in your coaching and in running the program?
Well, I think it's really important for a young man to have outlets. This is a really, when you talk in terms of 18, 19, 20, 21 years old, there's a lot of soul searching. There's a lot of searching in life of what kind of young man, where are we landing here? And those choices and decisions that a young man makes, you know, form, you know, as he moves forward. And so I think it's really important to have a lot of outlets within the organization that they can reach out to. And it may not be the head coach. It may not be the coordinator. It may not be the position coach or the coach that recruited you, but it might be the person on the side, the support staff, that they're able to lean on. And that's really important to me. Again, we're here to service the players. That's really important to me, that they have a great experience. Is it all going to be easy? No. Is it all going to be perfect? No. Is it all going to be great days? No. We're going to have some tough days. That's part of it. But through that process, have enough outlets for the young men to be successful.
With that, we'll let Coach relax for a minute. Any questions for Coach Tanner?
Okay.
That's always a paramount discussion that we have at the university level with our board of trustees. And while it's difficult many times, Coach Muschamp mentioned the academic center, the Doty, and that's where our training table is. That's where our academic community is for all of our student athletes, and it has been tremendous for us and very successful. That is an area that our student athletes come together. It's difficult to get everything in the location that you want because we're landlocked to a certain extent. But that is always a discussion, and I feel comfortable in telling you that of our facilities, the Doty is a special place where all the sports are together for meals and study and camaraderie. So that is a special environment for our student athletes.
Right. Coach, you talked about going into this, you just wanted to find the right fit. Was there a moment that it kind of stuck out, or just that moment that you know this guy was the right fit?
Well, I think that, you know, you go back in time, and you know, we're all fans. I assumed the role that I had to be more than a fan, and you watch people across the country, and we all know about Coach Muschamp, the passion, enthusiasm, desire, but he was very relational with his players. He had academic priorities. His experiences in the past, everybody says good things about him, from the presidential level to his student athletes. So that was very important to me. I actually had a conversation with him probably a year ago at this point, unrelated to being the head coach at the University of South Carolina, but it stuck. It stuck with me, just the conversation and the tone. I do think that, you know, being a former coach, there was a connection, there was a bond. And, you know, I would like to say one thing. My wife told me this morning, don't talk too much. So I have to be careful. But you talk about his past. And winning 28 games at the University of Florida in his 4 years, that many would say, well, that's not acceptable, that's not good enough. There's two coaches right now in the college football playoffs that one won 28 and one won less than 28. So I coached for a long time. It's not perfect. It's not a perfect scenario. But it's about the other things that count. Winning games we all like, but the relationship that you have with your players, the impressions that you make upon them, you help them develop as young men, great athletes, if they can do it while they're playing for you. But there's a lot of things that are important, and that's what Will Muschamp stands for.
Gino?
Hey Ray, to what extent during your pursuit and when you decided to hire Will, did you talk to Steve Spurrier, and what kind of input did he have?
I talked to Coach Spurrier periodically along the way. I actually spoke with him yesterday for a moment or two. I think it's very important. He has been in the game for a long time. Certain people have made an impact with him personally and as a coach, and certainly Coach Muschamp was in that category. So that was important to me to hear it from a person that's been in the game for a long, long time.
John?
How much outside pressure did you feel from a timetable perspective, and did that influence you in any way?
John, you've known me for a long time. I can be a little bit hard-headed. And the fact that there were so many openings throughout the country this year and jobs were getting filled and I was getting some pressure, but it did not affect me. I knew what the timetable was when we started. I knew the last weekend of college football season was November 28th. While we were doing tremendous research and having a lot of conversations with athletic directors and coaches that may not be in the game, there was a respect level that you know where you are in this process. And then there was a championship game last weekend. So the timetable, I felt, was perfect when we started, and we got to the place that we needed to with the right man. And maybe Coach Muschamp and Charles Waddell would tell you that it was a little more thorough and extensive than it needed to be. I felt good about it. I think you know, just like when Coach is talking about the investment you make in a program, that's the way I took this job. I wanted to be right, and the time did not affect me, and we got it right.
Let me try that too, because there were times when, you know, I revert to being a fan from being the president, and I was getting, you know, anxious too. Not so much any lack of trust or faith, but, you know, you're hearing it from the fans, and we just want to get our coach. You know, we want to move on. We want to turn the page. But every time I called him, he convinced me he was doing it the right way. He said, "President, I'm looking for a coach for a decade or more. Can I take a few more hours?" I said, sure. He said, you know, he said, I could make a decision sooner, but we're talking not about a quick thing. Can I check the background? Can I call people? Can I have a long interview and maybe call someone back the following day? Would that be okay? Is that too much to ask? And I said, not at all. So I'm convinced that, although to the fans it took longer than some would have wanted, I think he took exactly the right amount of time. And Coach, let me just say, you know, you've done great today, but your comment about your family and Carol is amazing. Let me say, to keep Ray and I happily married, Patricia and Karen are amazing wives too. So I just want to...
There's a reason why you survived this long.
David?
Ray, sort of a similar question to John. Did the volume of openings this offseason, perhaps some of them unexpected, ever lead you to have to maybe ever complicate your search efforts or ever lead you to maybe refocus them?
It really didn't. You know, I don't know if it was confidence or arrogance. I can't tell you. And again, Charles Waddell was with me every moment. I was always concerned about what was right for the University of South Carolina. And if there was a coach that went somewhere or jumped to this or went that place, he wasn't the right guy. So I never became concerned with that. I think that having been in the game so long, I've been in on a campus of college that has a high level of athletics, that you'll know when it's right. And I didn't get concerned about the openings or the timetable.
Rick.
Ray, what kind of conversations did you have with Coach Muschamp about his sideline demeanor? And if there is a blow up, are you going to put him in timeout?
Well, you know, honestly, we had a very serious, lengthy conversation. And I get it. I've been there. It's not perfect. But I was concerned that, you know, during our conversation, I might have been a little bit too firm, but he understands. You know, we're all coaches, and we want everything that Coach Muschamp brings to this program with his players, with his passion and enthusiasm. And I even like a little bit when you have to get on an official. You know, when they throw a flag, that's a little bit too far. But we talked about it extensively, and he certainly understands where we are.
Go to the back.
Ray, what's your message to the fans? I mean, let's be honest, a lot of fans did not like this hire, if you're on social media. So what do you say to them? I like the hire. I know Coach Muschamp's a great hire, by the way. But what do you say to them? Because a lot of folks don't like it, so this is a mistake. So if you had to look in the camera and say, Gamecock fan base, this is why, what would you say to them?
I would say that we got our man. We got a Gamecock. Buckle up your seatbelt. Get on board. Here we go. And if you want to be fast and furious, that's where we're going. And I'm patient. I understand. As you know, we have some very loyal, passionate Gamecocks, and they've been with us for a long time. So they'll be ready to go. I'm confident of that.
I think that's a good way to end this press conference right there. That's a great way to end. Photo opportunity for those of you who like. We'll have Coach Muschamp, Dr. Bestes, Coach Tanner up here. TVs, if you want to start heading down to the field for the one-on-ones that we talked about, you can do so at this time. Thank you all for coming.